Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents Blood on the Blade by Griff Hosker, narrated by Marston York. Prologue. My name is Erik. My father was called by some Lars the Luckless. It was an ironic nickname. It was not his luck which was bad, it was his temper. However, as his temper normally resulted in dire consequences for him, perhaps it was an appropriate name. He never had a temper at home. In fact, he was always smiling and cracking jokes. It was when he was with his Orr brothers that he lost his temper. We learned this through the words of those close to him. He did not suffer fools gladly. We did not see him that often. More times than enough he'd be away raiding. Sometimes he might be away for a year or more. His arrival home normally coincided with another child, which would inevitably be born when he was away. In those days, it was my mother, Maeve, who held the family together. We lived on a small farm on Orkneyjar. Orkneyjar was the name we gave to the islands off the Pictish coast. Our home was on the island of Rolfsey. My uncle, Snorri, and his family had their farm within sight of ours. The Viking after whom the island was named had left long ago. We heard that he had gone to the land of the Saxons. We had a few sheep and a couple of goats. We fished the bay and collected shellfish from the rich waters. When we were old enough, we fished. But my tale begins when we had no boat. I grew up with my older brother Arne. I had no sisters. Many men thought that made Lars lucky. My mother did not think so. When I was little, I wondered if she had named him luckless. Each of those who would have been my sisters had died before they were a month old. She had two boys, and both survived. My mother was a Saxon and a Christian. She managed to hide her religion from all, for my father had a deep hatred of the white Christ. I know she had a wooden cross, but she kept it hidden when my father was at home. She had been a slave. My father had taken her from Whitby in the land of Northumbria. She had been taken along with an old Saxon, Edmund. He was our thrall. Now that land was Danish. But my father had taken her when he had followed Backseg and Helfdene, the two Viking leaders who had ravaged through Mercia, Wessex and the Saxon kingdoms. He had not been luckless then, for he had returned with mail, a wife and a chest of coins. More, he was not there when the Saxons inflicted the final defeat on the Danes and Norse. That was the year he brought my mother to his farm and my brother was born. He took my mother because she was pretty, and also because she was hardy. She fought him. Others who were taken threw themselves from the Drekar on the way back to Orkneyjar. My father also brought a slave. He had hamstrung Edmund so that he could not run. He came from the same village as my mother, and they knew each other. Edmund was much older than my mother. His wife had been taken by another Viking who lived on Bjarnaroy. Edmund was a Christian. He prayed openly that he and his wife would be reunited. If my father caught him doing so, then he would beat him. Luckily for Edmund, my father was away more than he was at home. Our nearest neighbours were my uncle's family. Snorri Longfingers was my father's younger brother. His wife, Gita, was Norse. She was a Volva, and they had two children, Helge and Siggy. We all lived on the north of the island. It was not a safe beach, and scavenging for shellfish was a hazardous experience. The two families would join together to do so. My uncle and my father got on well, and so there was never a dispute over ownership of animals. Even so, they kept their homes a good 1,000 paces from each other. The brothers were Oar brothers. They spent every day at sea sharing an oar. It was natural that when they came home they would wish to spend the time with their families. When I was born, my father and his brother were at their most successful. They had returned with the other warriors from Orkneyjar. All of them had so much treasure that he spent a whole year at home. I was a babe and knew nothing at the time, but when I was older, I was told this. I was barely 4 summers old when I had my first adventure on the sea. I was rather in the sea than on it. My brother, Arne, and I had been sent by my mother to collect shellfish. Although dangerous, it was how Viking boys learned to face and overcome adversity. I soon bored of it, especially when I found a broken piece of wood in the rock pool. It was from a ship. The waters to the north and west of us were empty. Ships sailed there, but in the winter there was ice, which took many ships. We were used to finding wood, but this one was slightly different. It looked to be from the keel of a ship. It had been in the water a long time. I turned it over in the water and saw something carved upon it. It was a name written in runes. Begig. I did not know the name, but I felt a shiver down my spine. This was the name of the man who had built the ship. My father longed for a ship. We had the keel of one, the snekka we were building, on the beach, but it was a skeleton only. A snekka was the smallest warship our people used. My father and his brother Snorri had carved the names in the keel. None of their runes looked like these. I ran my fingers over the letters. They had been well carved. The builder had taken time over them, and now his ship was sunk. The wood still floated. I had a sudden thought. I would sail as though I was on a ship. I pulled myself up and sat astride the piece of wreckage. In those days I was small. It was later that I grew. I used my hands to paddle and kicked with my feet. I felt the wind in my face. I moved easily, yet I could feel the water tugging at my feet. The tide was ebbing. I played with the wreckage. I used my hands and feet to turn it. I let the tide pull me out and then the wind push me back. I was not afraid of the sea. Arne and I could swim. I had dived to the bottom to collect stones for my sling. Then I heard Arne as he shouted me. His words made me start, and a wave, or perhaps the Norns, threw me into the water. I did not panic. The beach was just 30 paces from me. As I broke the surface, I saw the wood drifting out to sea. I was heading west, beyond the seas sailed by men. I was going towards the unknown. Arne's voice called me back. Reluctantly, I swam. The wood had been sent for a reason. The threads of the shipbuilder and of me had touched, and now they were joined. The Norns had spun. That moment drew me to the sea and what lay beyond the horizon. My father spent his time ashore making a better shield and building a snekka. He did not farm. A snekka was a mixture of a drekar and a nar. It was as long as a nar, but narrower, and could not accommodate as much cargo. It was like a drekar, fast, and used oars. Unlike a drekar, it did not have a high prow. If a snekka met a drekar, then its only hope was flight. My father and his brother thought to go trading and raiding. A snekka would allow them to do that with a small crew. Most snekka could be crewed by just a handful of men. I was much bigger by the time they had finished it. They raided a few more times, but each time that my father returned, he was unhappier with the leadership of the clan. When I was old enough to help around the farm and fish with my brother, the jarl, Eystein Ronveld's son, called upon the men of the island for a raid. This was not a raid for treasure. They were heading to the mainland to make war on the Picts. Some Picts had raided one of the smaller islands and stolen sheep and cattle. Their king, Owen Goose MacEaganin, had refused to hand over those who had stolen the animals, and the raid was to punish them. My father was less than happy to go. As he told us before he left, there was little treasure to be had from such poor people. Nor did he believe that the raid would deter the Picts. But he was a loyal member of the clan, and he obeyed the Jarl. That was when the name Luckless began to be applied to him. That was when he became more bad-tempered on the raid than he had been. We learned this not from my father, but from his brother. He was away for half a year, and when he returned, that was when I grew up. Chapter 1. When I had seen more than 12 summers, my father took me and Arne with him on a raid. Siggy, my cousin, was just 4 moons older than I was, and he would be going on his first raid too. We had lost another baby girl the previous year, and my mother was with child again. My cousin Helga came to stay with her while we raided. Githa was a volva, and she could manage without her daughter. My mother needed help. I knew that Edmund would protect her, but Helga was a girl. As my mother was with child again, it made sense. At the time, I did not care. I was young, and become used to baby sisters dying young. I hoped that this one would be a boy. Selfishly, I thought of myself. I was going on a raid. To a Viking boy, that was all that was important. Now that I'm older, I see the world differently. Then, I looked at it through a boy's eyes. I would tread the deck of a Drekkar. Moondragon was the warship of Eystein Ronvaldsson. My father had described her to me. She had 15 oars on each side, and her prow had a black dragon head. The teeth were painted alternately red and white. The carver had made them look as though they were snapping. I could not wait to see her, and I was excited to be sailing on such a fine ship. It was as we neared the ship that my father began to change. The jokes he had cracked as we tramped to Westerness, where we would join the Jarl, stopped, and his face showed a frown rather than a smile. It was later I knew why. He did not like to serve the Jarl. He did not respect the Jarl. We spied the mast as we crested the rise. He and his brother laid the chest they were carrying on the ground. He turned to Arne and me. "Now, you two must not let me down. I have no time to watch over you, pair. I do not want the Jarl or any of the other warriors complaining about you. Neither your uncle nor I have any time to wipe your nose. This is your first step on your journey to becoming a warrior. You sleep on the deck and you will eat when we have been fed. The ship master will be the one who tells you what to do. There will be other boys aboard and they will have sailed before. If you wish to ask questions, then ask them." The three of us looked at each other. Arne said, "Where do we raid? The land of the Picts." Snorri stroked Arne's head with his famously long fingers. "The Picts have nothing worth stealing. We sail to raid the Wallahs. They are the people who live close to Mercia. The Mercians have lost much to the Wallahs. I know not why, for the Wallahs do not wear mail and their weapons are poor. It's only their arrows we fear, and your father and I wear mail. We will be safe, and when we raid them, then we will be rich." I saw my father nodding. "You need to watch and learn, for when you are older, we shall have our own ship. And then we will be as rich as the Jarl. Richer, for we are better warriors." Snorri shook his head. "Brother, it is saying things like that which gets you into trouble. We have had to be farmers because you insulted the Jarl the last time we raided."
"A warrior must speak what is on his mind. If he did not like it, then he could have challenged me."
"And he would have lost. There are none who can best you. The clan all know that you're the best warrior."
He shook his head.
"Come, we have a ship to board, and you are filling the boys' heads. They will need all of their wits about them if they're to survive. This will not be an easy voyage."
"You're right, we have talked enough.
pick up the chest, and let us board.
There was a jetty which led from the land to the Drekar. I saw other men from the islands as they carried their chests down the jetty to the Drekar. Most carried them singly. My father and his brother had a larger chest than most, and it contained all that they owned. They were close. There were other warriors with whom they would share the title Oa brothers, but Snorri and Lars were closer than any Oa brother. They were brothers of the blood. All that we three had, we carried on our backs. Apart from the kirtle and breeks we wore, we had a sealskin cape, a blanket, a sling, a bone knife tucked into a leather belt, a carved wooden bowl, a horn for beer, and Thor's hammer also carved in wood and tied by a thong around our neck. Arne had spoken to other boys who had sailed on Drekar, and he was confident that we would come back with more than we left. We hoped for a dagger or a seaxe at the very least. The next time we sailed, we would not have so little, and we would also be bigger. As we wound down the path to the sea, I wondered at my uncle's comments. My father was a warrior. I knew that already. But I did not know he was such a good one. He never spoke of his raids. Mother and Edmund were also tight-lipped about my father. I was excited that I would see my father fight, and I would judge for myself. The two brothers were bareheaded. Their helmets were with their war gear in the chest. Their swords and short mail byrne were also with their war gear. They carried their shields upon their backs and had their daggers in their belts. They both had sealskin boots and capes. There might be few trees on our island, but there were seals aplenty. Their leather jerkins were studded with metal. My uncle had told me that they were arrows which had been used by our enemies. After a battle or a raid, nothing was wasted. I thought it was clever to use something which might have wounded a warrior to protect himself in the future. I would have to wait until I was a warrior before I could have my own shield. As we neared the jetty, I was able to study the other warriors who were boarding the Drekar. My uncle and father looked bigger than they did. It looked to me as though everyone had done as my father and uncle had done. Their war gear was in their chests. According to my father, we had up to 20 days of sailing before their war gear would be needed. The sea could be cruel to swords, mail and helmets. They would be wrapped in grease and sheepskins. Men might have to endure the elements, but not their weapons. I saw that we would be almost the last to board. I had never met the Jarl, but I knew who he would be. He was the warrior greeting the crew as they came aboard. He had plaited hair, beard, and moustaches. He had warrior bands about his arms and neck. My father did not hold with such adornments. He believed that a warrior was a fighter. He did not need to pose. The Jarl had his sword strapped to his belt. It was a richly adorned belt, and the scabbard had a dragon running down it. The cheek was its tail, and the head looked to be forming the hilt of the sword. Unlike my father and uncle's swords, this had a detailed pommel, and there were silvered threads in the grip. His jerkin had regular studs of metal which were in neat lines, and I saw, hanging from his neck, a silver Thor's hammer. He wore his helmet. It, too, had greatly detailed engraving upon it. It was a half-mask helmet. My father and uncle wore a simple one with a nasal. Finally, his fingers had two rings on each hand. One was a dragon. It was studded with stones. The Jarl was rich. I wondered why my father did not wear such things. I was impressed by the Jarl. The smile with which he had greeted the other crew members was replaced by a serious face. "Welcome, Lars and Snorri. You have brought your sons. It is time they learned what it is to be a warrior. This reed will show them. They will serve as ship's boys until they are big enough to row." The Jarl nodded. "You three, go to the steering board. The steersman is Ulf Northstar. He will tell you your duties." He looked down at me. I was the smallest. "Can you swim?" I nodded.
Aye, Jarl. Good. If you fall from the ship, we do not come back for you. You will have to swim home.
I was unsure if he was joking, and I ran after Arne to speak with the man who would get us where we needed to go. Ulf Northstar was the colour of an oak barrel. He looked like one too. I almost giggled, but feared a smack for my trouble. A better name would have been Ulf the Barrel. He wore a leather jerkin and had scuffed seal boots on his feet. At his waist, he had a long, rounded dagger which looked like a long bodkin needle and a wicked-looking sea-axe. He put his hands on his hips.
I have three boys who have been on a voyage with me before. One is my grandson. They know how to make this trekker fly. You three know nothing. The best you can do is keep out of the way of those who know what they are doing.
He pointed to the mast.
That is where you will be needed. If I shout for the sail to be reefed, then you get to the top as soon as you can. You spread out, and when my grandson, Olaf Olafsson, tells you, then you pull up the sail and secure it. He will show you the knot you use. If I say lower the sail, then you do the opposite.
Arne said, Is that it? Ulf smacked him so hard on the side of the head that I thought he would fall over.
Did I tell you to speak?
Holding back the tears, Arne shook his head. I bunched my fists. If he hit me, I would hit him back.
Of course not. Olaf will tell you all of your duties, but know this. On the last voyage, two of the boys who set out with us did not return.
He seemed to take pleasure in that. I did not like the Master Mariner.
Olaf, here are the boys.
Olaf looked to be older than us. He looked much bigger than we were, and I wondered when he would take an oar. He gestured for us to go to the prow. There was a small piece of canvas rigged over it. When we got there, he said, This is your home. The little time you have for rest you will spend here. This is my last voyage on Moon Dragon as a ship's boy. I took an oar next time we raid. You will be the last boys I train. I looked up at him. He had a sea-axe in his belt. His leather jerkin was well made. He wore no boots, but his breeks were made from sealskin. I was going to ask him a question and then thought better of it. I would not risk a clip. He took three pieces of old rope. These are for you three. Once we're at sea and there's time, I will show you how to tie ropes. The knots we use each have a purpose. I will tell you the purpose. Leif Ragnarsson and Carl the Climber are the other boys. They will also tell you what to do. Most of the time you three will take ale and food to the men at the oars. If it is quiet and you have mastery of knots, then you will run lines to catch fish. You will work harder than you have ever worked. If you survive and have done well, then the Jarl may reward you.
He pulled out his sea-axe.
He gave me this after we raided Saxons. He gave me coin, too. Now, go and climb the stays and see if you can reach the masthead. I would have you sit on the crosspiece.
Siggy said hesitantly, Stays?
Instead of a clip, Olaf smiled.
The ropes which secure the mast to the hull. There are four of them. The other way up is to climb the mast, but the stays are quicker. Now, go. We'll leave as soon as the last oarsmen are aboard.
We ran to the ropes. There were four of them, and I picked one close to my father. I saw him and my uncle watch us as they secured the chest. I grabbed the rope and swung my legs up. It was slippery and salty. This would not be an easy climb. I had an advantage over my brother and my cousin. I used to climb the cliffs close to our home and steal seabirds' eggs. I was not afraid of heights, and I was stronger in the arms than Siggy. Even so, by the time I reached halfway, I was tiring. I had to carry my weight too. I wondered if it might be easier climbing above the rope. Even though I was tiring, I reached the yard first. After the climb, I found it easy to swing myself up and sit across the spar. I noticed that the hemp cord which secured the sail was like the bowstring my father used. I saw the knot. I had used one before. It was secure, but it could be released by a simple pull. Arne joined me, and then Siggy huffed and puffed his way up. We all grinned. We had succeeded in our first task. Ulf Northstar shouted,
"No! Get down! We wish the seal!"
I knew there would be a quick way to get down, but I chose to use the safer method. I came slowly down with my feet wrapped around the rope. Arne just used his hands, and Siggy made the mistake of trying to slide down the rope. He made it halfway, and then the burning was so severe that he had to let go and crashed to the deck. Men laughed. Of the three older ship's boys, it was only Carl who thought it was hilarious. Olaf and Leif looked concerned. I saw my uncle go to him and help him to his feet. We landed on the deck and went to him. The palms of his hands were red raw. His father shook his head.
"What's your cousins? They have more sense. How is your leg?"
Siggy was more embarrassed than anything else. He shook his head.
"It is fine."
My uncle went to the mastfish to fetch his oar. Olaf shook his head as he approached.
"You did well, Erik Larsen. I have hopes for you."
"As for you, Siggy Snorrison, I hope your father has another son, for I feel that you will be feeding the fishes. Arne and Erik, get to the ropes and prepare to untie them. Wait for my grandfather's command. Untie them and throw them aboard, and then leap."
Arne said, "Leap?" He laughed.
"Aye, leap, for the oars will be pushing us off."
There were just two ropes securing us. Arne said, "I will take the bow." I nodded and went to the steerboard rope. I saw that it was held by the end, which was tucked inside the coils. I took a chance and began to loosen it. I heard the jarl shout, "Up, oars!" The oars rose. Then Ulf shouted,
"Let loose the ropes!"
In one tug, the end came loose and I unwound it as fast as I could. I know not why I did it, but I coiled the rope in my hand as I did so. I managed to release it before Arne. I threw the coiled rope aboard and then leapt. The Drekar was just a pace away from the jetty. I easily caught the gunwale and slipped my leg over. I saw my father nod and smile at me. Arne had been just a little slower and the Drekar was two paces and more from the jetty. Arne barely made the gunwale and he hung there. Siggy went to him and helped to pull him aboard. No one else helped. I saw then that we would have to help each other if we were to survive our first voyage. We had no time to even begin to think. Olaf shouted, "Ship's boys to the mastfish!" Meanwhile, the oars were run out and we were pushed out from the land. The jarl held a staff. The top had been carved into a dragon head. He began to stamp on the deck to give the rowers the beat. My father had told me when they were at sea, they would sometimes sing. We began to move. Olaf pointed to the spar.
"We climb up. Siggy and Arne, you come with me, and we'll be on the steerboard side. You three, take the other."
I took that as a compliment. Carl went to the mast, and he began to climb there. He cast a superior look at Siggy. I used the same rope, and I hauled myself up. I reached the yard at the same time as Leif, who nodded.
"He did well."
Carl joined us and just scowled. He did not like me. I saw that poor Siggy was struggling. He had not had time to apply the salve his mother had given him. He had had a poor start and he could not afford another disaster. Carl was the closest to the masthead. I was in the middle and Leif was over the sea. He saw my look and shrugged.
"The sea is softer than the deck."
Carl laughed.
"But as your head is soft and as addled as a bad egg, it makes little difference. You'll never be Viking warriors."
I saw the look of horror on poor Siggy's face. When my cousin finally made it to the spar, Olaf shouted,
"This will be the only time we can do this at our leisure. It'll take some time to reach the sea."
He pointed to the pennant. It was red.
"The wind is from the north and east. The gods favour us. The blute was a good one. When we are nearer to the land of the Wellas, it will be harder, for there the winds come from the west."
I was able to look out and saw the largest island, Orkneyjar, to the south and west of us. We were sailing north and west up the channel. I saw the smoke from the many longhouses there. There were few trees now anywhere. Often our raids would be to places where we could get some wood. When our snekka was finished properly and seaworthy, then we were going to sail it to the land of the Picts. My father wanted a drekar. It would not be a large one, but he wanted to be a leader. He had had enough of following. I knew from talking to my uncle that a drekar could move very quickly. We were using oars at the moment, but once we reached the sea and turned, then we could lower the sail and we would fly. I was enjoying the experience, although as the sail was furled and we were protected by the land, there was not so much movement as there might have been. I glanced down and saw that Siggy was clinging to the spar. The burning hands and the crash to the deck had unnerved him. I saw ahead the open sea. I took hold of the end of the hemp cord which bound the sail. I had 6 to untie. I knew that Ulf Northstar would be highly critical of us. He would be looking for errors. I saw the jarl as he glanced up. He might have been looking at the pennant, but he would have seen us. My father and uncle were just toiling at the oar they shared. We had a big crew. There were 60 men on board. We were stronger because of that, but we would need to find a sizable target to make it worth our while. Olaf shouted, "Ready to loose the seal!" I looked down and saw that we had almost cleared the land. His grandfather must have given him a signal. Ulf shouted, "Loose seals!" I untied the first cord and quickly did the same to the others. The 3 of us on my side of the mast were fast, for our half of the sail dropped quickly. Siggy, perhaps because of his hands, was a little slower. We moved faster as Ulf put the steering board over and shouted, "In oars!" I could tell that we had disappointed him, for he glared up at the sail. Eventually, Siggy managed to untie the last one and the sail filled. Olaf shouted, "Down, quickly!" I saw that he and Leif had pieces of leather. They slipped them over the rope and flew down to the deck. I wondered how they would stop, but amazingly, they slowed and landed perfectly. They both ran to the 2 foresheets and began to tighten them. I landed and ran to the stern sheet on the steerboard side. I pulled on it, but I had little effect. Leif ran from the forestay and said, "There's a trick to this." He pointed to a wooden cleat in the gunwale. "Wind it around this and pull." I helped him and found it much easier. We tied it off. "Thank you." He smiled. "You will do, but your cousin may struggle." I saw that Siggy had made the mistake of passing too close to Ulf. He was hit on the back of the head with a piece of knotted rope.
"Clumsy lump of crab bait, you're letting down the crew."
Olaf stood by the mastfish and waved us over. "Come, you 3. It's not time. Carl and Leif, stand by Ulf." Leif looked sympathetically at Siggy while Carl laughed. I knew then that Carl and I would come to blows. He might be older than me and a whole head taller, but I would fight him. We worked at the knots until our hands bled. To be fair to Siggy, he found that much easier than the rest of the tasks, and Olaf was able to praise him. When we had finished, Olaf and the other 2 were sent to tighten and adjust the stays. We were given the job of taking ale and food to the crew. I saw the look of concern on my uncle's face as we neared him. He had a small jug and he said, "Here, Siggy, smear this on your hands." Siggy nodded and said quietly, "I'm sorry, Father. I have let you down."
"You have not, my son. I found it as hard, and if it was not for Uncle Lars here, I might have never returned."
My father chuckled.
"I sailed with our helmsman as a youth. Ulf Northstar was younger then, but just as handy with his rope. He learned then that my fists are like Thor's hammer."
He smiled at Siggy.
"When we have our own drekar, this will not be a problem. I will steer."
As we continued to serve food and ale, I realised I was learning as much about my father as I was myself. He did not like the jarl, and he did not like the steersman. They did not like him either. Their looks showed that, and Ulf's treatment of us. It was no wonder my father did not get on with either of them. This would be a difficult voyage. By the time night fell, we were exhausted. The jarl did not wish to stop, and so we sailed through the night. Each of us took it in turns to stand by Ulf or the jarl at the steering board. Siggy woke me for my turn. There was an hourglass at the stern and a candle in a pot. We each did two turns of the glass. When I reached the steering board, it was the jarl who was steering.
"Go fetch me a horn of ale."
"Aye, jarl." I hurried to the barrel of ale, which was close to the mastfish, and ladled beer into it. I hoped I had it right. Some men like a foamy head and others did not. I handed it to the jarl and he drank. I had not displeased him and I felt some relief. It was a clear night, and when he had downed the ale, he handed me the horn and looked up at the stars. He must have realised our course was not true, and I saw him adjust it. After a while, he turned and said,
"So, Erik Larsen, what would you be, a mariner or a warrior?"
"Could I not be both?" He laughed.
"You are just like your father, for to be both, you have to have your own ship and crew. That is what your father wishes."
He shook his head.
"You have the blood of a Saxon and Norse. It seems that Norse wins."
A strange smile came over him.
"You just have to survive this voyage, is all. I think, however, that you have more chance of that than your cousin. We will see."
And that was all that he said. I turned the glass when it needed, and I watched the black night slip by. There was no feature save the sea. How did the jarl and Ulf navigate? Were they galdramen? I determined to watch them. My father could tell me things, but the jarl and his helmsman had done this more than my father. I waited until the glass had run out and I turned it before I went to wake Arne. The three newcomers had been given the most undesirable of watches. I thought I detected a slight smile on the jarl's face as I went to wake my brother. I curled up on the blanket he had left and pulled my own over me. I was so exhausted that I was asleep before Arne had reached the steering board. Chapter 2. For the next days, we followed the same routine. The three of us, as new boys, were run ragged. We passed up and down the Drekker as well as up and down the stays. Hands became tougher and muscles grew. What had seemed impossible the first day became acceptable by the third. We also became invisible. It was though we could not be seen save as a hand which filled an ale horn or fetched some salted meat. I kept my eyes and ears open and I learned things. I saw that the jarl had a small band of warriors he kept close to him. These were not oath sworn. They were men from the islands. Bjorn Bjornsson was the closest. They did not like my father, and I heard many disparaging comments from them. My father also sat with close friends. They sat forward of the mast, and it was obvious that my father was leader. I saw his temper flare as he openly criticised the jarl and his choice of target. My father felt that the Mercians were more likely to yield treasure and grain. He was loud in his criticism, and his voice carried down the Drekker. The jarl heard. I also learned why none silenced him. He was acknowledged, even by his many enemies, as the best warrior on the Drekker. The jarl himself tacitly admitted this when he came to my father and asked him and his Ore brothers to be the first to land. Even when my father mocked the jarl's oath sworn, the jarl took the criticism. It was then that I understood about my father's dream of a Drekker. If he had a Drekker,
then he would not need the jarl. I asked Olaf one morning as the wind took us and we had time to chat how much it cost to build the drekker. It is not something to be taken lightly. There are some things which any could get, he smiled. Any who do not live on treeless Orkneyjar. You need good straight timbers for the keel and strakes. Then you need different wood for the decks. You need pine for the mast and spars. The last thing you need is time. It takes months, perhaps years, to build a good drekker. At last I understood. We now had a snekke, which was almost ready to launch, but it had taken a long time to build. As we sailed south, I grew up. Living on the farm with just my brother and cousin for company, I had not had to interact with any. Now I had to endure the bully that was Carl. Not only was he bigger than we were, he enjoyed special treatment. His father's friendship with the jarl meant he never had the hard duties. He enjoyed throwing his considerable weight around, sometimes quite literally. He would try to barge into us as we hurried down the decks. I learned to have quick feet and to dance around him. I did not know that it would stand me in good stead when I became a warrior. The Norns were spinning, and I was being prepared to be a Viking. We passed beyond the land of Strathclyde and headed towards the land of the wolf. We saw the land of the Hibernians to the west, and I noticed that the crew became more agitated. Leif was always the easiest to talk with. Like Olaf, he would soon be taking an oar. Carl had another few voyages left. I was not looking forward to the time when Carl was in charge. Perhaps my father would have finished our ship by then. Leif, why are the men sharpening weapons? We're not near the land of the Wallahs, are we?
We are not, but you're right. We have many more days before we raid. The men fear the pirates of man.
He pointed south.
There it is. It is ruled from Dilfin and Vesifjörður. Sometimes there is conflict in those kingdoms, and when that happens, the folk who live on that island raid. Thorvald Asvaldsson and his crew were attacked when they passed the island 6 months since. Some think we should come and make war on them. It may come to that.
He patted the sayax he wore in his belt.
If we are attacked, I will defend myself. But there will be no shame if you and the others hide on the spar.
I was outraged, but I could not show it. If we were attacked, then I would show them that even though I was young, I could still fight. I might only have a sling and a bone knife, but I was a Viking. The wind was still with us, and we had had little to do save reef the sail at sunset and loose it at dawn. It was now blowing from the north and east. We could still use the wind. Leif had told me that the wind was turning. The Norns must have been spinning, for even as we headed towards the west to take the channel between Man and Vesifjörður, the wind began to weaken. I was still sufficient so that we would not need to use oars, but I saw men, my father included, taking out their swords and helmets from the chest. I saw some men touch their hammer of Thor. In those days I saw the sea, but I did not understand it. The crew did. They knew what the change in the wind meant. We could see Man quite clearly now. It rose from the sea like a cow which was eating grass. The small island to the south was called the Calf. I had heard the story. It had seemed charming and innocent, but now that I was here, it felt somehow sinister.
Erik, you have young eyes. Climb up the mast and tell me what you spy.
It was the jarl himself who had asked for me, and I ran to the forestay and quickly climbed it. I could now climb with confidence. Even Siggy had managed it, but he was still slow. I crawled along the spar and sat with my legs on either side of the mast. I looked to the island and realised that I could see much more from this elevated position. What I had taken to be a green lump rising from the sea could now be seen as having people and buildings. There was a harbour, or port of some description, for I saw stone and masts.
I see masts. Are they moving?
I felt my heart sink. I was about to give my judgment on something. If I got it wrong, then it could spell disaster for my Oa brothers. That would be viewed as a comment on my character. My father was Lars the Luckless. I did not want to be Erik the Unlucky. With a nickname like that, no one would sail with me. They're not moving yet.
Good. Shout if anything changes.
Ulf was trying to keep us out to sea, but the wind, slight though it was, had the effect of pushing us toward the land. The masts remained still. The spars had reefed sails. If they came out, they would be oared. I could not determine the size of the ships. I had seen few. How big was big? We drew closer, and I stared intently at the island. I could now see houses dotted on the hillside below the mountain. There was also a hall. It looked to be above the quay. The ships were now clearer. They did not look to be as big as ours. Just then I heard from below, "Oars!" I saw why. The wind was taking us even closer to the coast, and Ulf wanted some sea room. I saw a movement in the harbour. A mast move, but I saw no ship's boys to unfurl it. Ship leaving port! Below me, the oars had begun to bite. A wrist standing on the spar. I suddenly saw into the harbour. The ship which was leaving was a small drekker. I put her to be a Thretanessa, 13 oars on each side. It's a Thretanessa! I saw other masts move and spied two smaller ships. They were large snekke, and they were leaving too. Two snekke coming too. Jarl Eystein Ronvaldsson shouted, "Olaf, get the boys on the mast. Take your bows." I had no bow, but I did have my sling. Sitting, I took it from my pouch. I had 20 stones there too. Arne and I had tried to bring down a gull 2 days since. We had hit two, but the fish had been the ones to benefit. I chose a good stone and fitted it. Leif climbed first. He had a bow over his back and some arrows jammed into his belt. "Olaf will stand by his grandfather. You did well, Erik." He stood and shouted, "A third snekke putting out." He grinned at me. "Four ships for us to face on your first voyage. The gods have you marked." Karl clambered up, and he had a sling, as did Arne and Siggy when they joined us. Leif said, "Siggy, come here to the mast. It is safer." Karl snarled. "He is of no use to this crew. Better to have brought his sister. At least we could have some use out of her." My cousin Helga was considered beautiful. She was my cousin, and I did not see her like that. To me, she was just someone friendly who made me laugh. Before Leif could say anything, I said, "Do not insult my cousins, Karl the Climber, or you and I will have words." He pointed his finger at me. "Any time." Leif shouted, "Silence! Siggy, come here. Erik, go to the end." I concentrated on moving along the spar. We were moving quite quickly now, and the motion on the yard was extreme. I was grateful that Leif had allowed Siggy the chance to sit astride the mast. I saw that Ulf had managed to pull away from the coast, but we were now sailing into the wind. There was little point in furling the sail, for once we cleared the calf, then he could put the steering board over and lose these four terriers, which would soon be snapping at our heels. They had men at the oars, but the four were smaller and lighter than we were. We were carrying a month's supplies on board. I wondered if they would catch us. I heard a shout from below, but could not make it out. However, when half of the crew stood, I worked out what it was. The Jarl was preparing for the men to fight. He chose my father and his oar brothers for the task. My father donned his helmet and took his shield from the steerboard side. Leif pulled back on his bow and an arrow arced. It was a ranging arrow. It landed just a few paces before the drekker. The three snekke were now spreading out to encircle us. The drekker would stop us, while the snekke looked for a weakness at the steering board. Olaf would be in danger. He had neither helmet nor mail. I had been given no orders to use my sling, but as I had but 20 stones, I would need to be judicious. Leif's second arrow hit a rower on the drekker. They were not wearing mail, and his plunging arrow went into his shoulder. As the man slumped, his oar caught the two behind. With three oars out of commission, the drekker began to slew around. I took a chance and hurled my first stone. I was helped by the height of the spar. My stone hit one of the rowers at the front of the drekker. He had a helmet, but a stone could still hurt. I saw his head jerk forward.
Well done, Erik. The rest of you, aim at that drekker.
Leif only had 10 arrows. When he had used them, he would have to use his sling. We could not see what was happening astern. The drekker's slewed turn meant that she was just 30 paces from the larboard side of her ship. I saw men whirling grappling hooks. I threw my second stone. It hit one of those with hooks in the chest and he fell backwards, throwing the rowers into disarray. It was Siggy who sent the stone which thwarted the drekker. He hit the helmsman. The man had no helmet and the stone hit him hard on the cheek. The man let go of the steering board and the gap between us grew. As it did, I saw that we were almost abreast of the calf. I threw stone after stone into the drekker. An arrow was sent from the drekker at us. It struck the spar. Leif leaned over and worked it free. He knocked it and sent it back at the drekker. Ulf put the steering board over and we sailed dangerously close to the drekker.
In oars!
We now had the wind. The oars were shipped just a heartbeat before we passed the prow of the drekker. I had thought that we had succeeded, for as I sent another stone towards the steering board of the drekker, I saw that many of the crew had been hit by stones, arrows and oars. We had to turn to continue our assault, and as we did so, I saw that two of the snekker were within a length of us. They were gaining. By the time I had turned, the jarl had split the crew in two. I saw that my father and his brother were on the landward side. They stood together. The jarl and his hearth weru were on the steerward side. The crews of the snekke were brave. They were trying to slow us down until the others could come and join them. I hurled a stone and was rewarded when it hit the warrior who was standing at the prow and holding on to the forestay. I hit his chest, and he wore no mail. As he fell, I thought, for a moment, that he would fall into the sea, but he managed to hold on. He had to drop to one knee. I had hurt him. Our stones and Leif's arrows clattered into the snekke, but they had learned, and a wall of shields stopped any more injuries. From the two boats, 4 grappling hooks were hurled. They bit, and even though men tried to cut them, the damage had been done. The first warriors leapt aboard. Olaf, who was stood by his grandfather, took a hatchet and began to cut through the ropes, binding the snekke to the drekker. A warrior stood on the prow of his ship and raised his spear. Without mail and a helmet, Olaf would die. This time, my stone hit him perfectly. He had his arm pulled back and my stone hit him on the side of the head. He could not keep his balance and he fell into the sea. As he did so, Olaf severed the second grappling hook and the snekke lost way. The jarl led his men to go to the aid of my father. On the yard, we sent our last arrows and stones at those trying to leap the gap. When my father and the jarl slew the two men who had boarded, my uncle severed the ropes and the snekke had lost any chance of capturing us. I heard a cheer from below. Leif said, "We did well. Let us go down. Siggy, you have the place of honour. Your stone was the one that truly saved us." By the time I reached the deck, the snekke and the drekker were heading back to port. Olaf greeted us. He was our leader. "Siggy, all of your clumsiness is forgiven, and Erik, I owe you a life." I did not know what to say. My father strode up and picked Arne and me up.
"My two little fighting cocks, you showed them all. My blood is the blood of a warrior."
He glowered and glared at the jarl. The jarl and Bjorn turned and headed towards the steering board. He had been insulted by my father. It seemed to diminish both our efforts and the victory. Ulf shouted,
"Ships, boys, serve ale and food."
I saw Leif talking to Olaf. Olaf nodded and said, "Carl, go and be lookout." Giving me murderous looks, Carl grabbed some stale bread and an ale skin. As he passed Siggy, he deliberately lurched against him and knocked him into the mastfish. Siggy's head hit it hard. He laughed at Siggy and clambered up the backstay. Olaf came over to me.
"Carl can be dangerous. It does not do to antagonise him."
"I know you worry about me, but if he hurts my family, then no matter how big he is, I will fight him."
"And you will lose."
I shrugged. "Perhaps, but he will know that he has fought." I looked up at the mast and Carl's back.
"Do you hear me, Carl the climber? Leave my family alone."
Olaf laughed and shook his head.
"You are your father's son. He does not back down either."
With the wind with us once more, we sailed a little more slowly south. Once we had passed the islands the Saxons called Anglesey, the Jarl decided to put in at a beach. He and Ulf had endured watch and watch about since we had left home. They knew of deserted beaches which could not be accessed from the land. He found one of those. We reefed the sail and we went in under oars. To me, this was all new. My father and uncle knew the beach. I thought it was a foreign land. As I stood by the prow with the rope ready.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.